Good morning to you. Let's stand to our feet, shall we? Righteous Lord, we come into the presence of the Most High God in the great, majestic, powerful, all-powerful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. And we thank you for this day, for this opportunity to be together, for this opportunity to serve you, to magnify your great name, to remind ourselves that you're God and we are not, and that our God reigns. Thank you, Father. Thank you, as I said to you earlier, thank you that your faithfulness is always there and you're always good, always, always good. Thank you so very much. Thank you for hearing us this morning. Thank you for receiving us this morning. Thank you for speaking to our hearts this morning. Thank you in advance for the great things you're going to do today. Father, we pray that you will be glorified by our lips, by our actions, by our responses today. And we ask it in the precious and wonderful name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
All right, well, we have a brand new year and a brand new opportunity to worship the Lord this Sunday. I hope you guys have come excited to do that, to worship God in a spirit of unity and a spirit of love for one another. I want to give you all just the opportunity to. I know New Year's brings New Year's resolutions, right? How many of you guys have made some resolutions this year? Any? So a couple, you know, to be healthy. Nah, Drew says, nope, I'm going to be the same as last year. That's right. So there you go. It worked for me last year. It'll work for me this year. So, but we have new opportunities to worship God. And I want to encourage you guys to think of some practical ways that you can worship the Lord this year. Maybe take on the challenge of reading the Bible through all the way through this whole year. Spend some time in prayer and reading the word every day. Discipline yourself for godliness, as Timothy says. And so we want to encourage you to do that. And if you guys ever have any questions about how to do that, me, Brother Kevin, Brother David, and some of your Sunday school teachers, so Brother Jim as well, we would love to tell you about that. We also want to welcome Brother Jim this morning. This is his first Sunday with us. I hope you guys can help me make him feel welcome. So thank you so much. For leading us in worship, Brother Jim. We're excited to go to the throne with you. Two more announcements we have. You see some announcements on this bulletin. If you don't have one, the ushers that will come down in just a moment will give you one. 5:30 tomorrow night, Beyond Our Walls will start up again. So we want you guys to come if you have the freedom to come to that. We have tons of ways that we can minister to our community through Beyond Our Walls, and I hope that you will come and support that. Also, we need some more workers for our food pantry and clothing closet. If you'll just see Miss Tara or Miss Anita about that, they would love to talk to you about that if you feel that that is a ministry that God is pulling you towards this year. So, if you're visiting with us today, so the ushers that are coming down the aisle right now, they have a bulletin for you. If you'll just tear off this tab right here and fill it out, either place it in the offering plate or leave it on your seat in just a moment. We'd just love to get to know you, see how we can minister to you and love on you there. If you'll just stay seated, if you're a visitor with us for this first little part during the welcome. And church members, let's stand, greet one another, tell somebody you're excited to worship with them this morning.
to sing with us as we lift our voices to the Lord this morning. I worship you, Almighty God. I worship you, Almighty God. There is none like you. I worship you. Some verses from Psalm 96. Sing to the Lord a new song. Sing to the Lord all the earth. Sing to the Lord. Praise his name. Proclaim his salvation day after day. Declare his glory among the nations, his marvelous deeds among the people. For great is the Lord and most worthy of praise. He is to be feared above all gods, for all the gods of the nations are idols. But the Lord, he made the heavens. Splendor and majesty are before him. Strength and glory are in his sanctuary. Ascribe to the Lord, O you families of the nations. Ascribe to the Lord glory and strength. Say among the nations, the Lord reigns. Lift him up. As we have been instructed to sing a new song many times in the scriptures. This one was written in 2010 for the Passion Conferences. It was co-written by Chris Tomlin and Matt Redman. I invite you to stand and lift this one up together. It's called Our God.
Open the eyes of the blind. There's no
People say amen.
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 We make a lot of the new year. We're making a lot of the first Sunday of the new year. But I would remind you that each day is a new day.
Yes.
Would you pray with me? Our Father in heaven, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here to worship you. We ask that you accept our worship and that it please you. We come now to the time where we give back what you have given to us. And Father, we ask that you use these tithes and offerings to your glory. I pray in Christ's name. Amen.
In the Old Testament, right after Elijah had the mountaintop experience in Mount Carmel, we find him running and he's hiding in a cave. Y'all remember the story? And he asked that he wanted to see the presence of the Lord and for the Lord to reveal himself. And so several things happened there in that passage of scripture. But I find it very interesting that when his heart was still, he saw God in the still small voice. And I don't know what you face this year. I don't know what your expectations for this next year will be. But one of my favorite patches of scripture is be still and know that I am God. Sometimes we just need to take time to be still and hear that soft, tender voice of our Father speaking to our hearts.
Softly and tenderly, Jesus is calling, calling for you and for me. See on the portals, he's waiting, he's watching, watching for you and for me. When Jesus, he's pleading, pleading for you and for me. Why should we linger and heed not his mercies? His mercies for you and for me.
Thank you, Jim. Let me remind you and present to you also Dorothy, who's seated over here beside him. Wave. Y'all wave at Dorothy. We've had so many confirmations of God's leadership to Brother Jim to be our worship leader. So many confirmations, not the least of which, if they didn't do it already, they are about to close on a house they've been trying to sell ever since they moved down here. What year? When did you move down here? This is your third year, 2 years ago. So my, how God has confirmed all of this for us. Well, Happy New Year to you. Isaiah chapter 5, one of our beloved church members requested this passage of scripture in our selected passages from Isaiah. And if y'all don't like it, I'll tell you who it was later. So, but anyway, this great man of God also a number of years ago wrote an op-ed in the Baptist Record, and it was printed, and he even dared to put his photograph with it. And he owned up to what he said. What he wrote was excellent, by the way, and you'll have to go back into the archives of the Baptist Record and look for it yourself. Back in 1970, what, Doc Raby? Oh, I wasn't going to tell you. 74. Y'all, that's 40 years ago. And he was pretty good looking 40 years ago. You know? Yes. Well, let's read the scripture. We're going to read the first, seven verses of this. Please stand to your feet when you find the passage of scripture. Let's read the word of God. It tells us this. Now let me sing to my well-beloved a song of my beloved regarding his vineyard. My well-beloved has a vineyard on a very fruitful hill. He dug it up and cleared out its stones and planted it with the choicest vine. He built a tower in its midst and also made a wine press in it. So he expected it to bring forth good grapes. But it brought forth wild grapes. And now, O inhabitants of Jerusalem and men of Judah, judge, please, between me and my vineyard. What more could have been done to my vineyard that I have not done in it? Why then, when I expected it to bring forth good grapes, did it bring forth wild grapes? And now, please, let me tell you what I will do to my vineyard. I will take away its hedge, and it shall be burned, and break down its wall, and it shall be trampled down. I will lay it waste, and it shall not be pruned or dug, but there shall come up briars and thorns. I will also command the clouds that they rain no rain on it. For the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel, and the men of Judah are his pleasant plant. He looked for justice, but behold oppression, for righteousness, but behold a cry for help. Father, take this word, teach us from this word, show us what you would have us to know today. We give you glory and praise through Jesus. Amen. Now you can be seated. Let me tell you that if I were able to call a joint session of Congress in the United States of America, what I'm going to share with you this morning with the 38th family and our guests, I would have shared or would share before the entire Congress of the United States of America. Now, quite honestly, that's not enough. I wished I could have a world platform and proclaim what I want to share with you this morning. But I want to take you through this passage of Scripture, not just the vineyard, but what follows it, because what follows the parable of the vineyard is an amplification, an explanation of why he has said what he said about Israel, about Judah. And so we want to see this passage in the context and light with which God has given it to us. So I'm going to give it to you through three truths this morning: God's parable about his work, and then God's proclamation of woes, and I will end it with a prophetic warning from God that is in the end of the chapter. So listen quickly this morning while we go through this passage and we study what God has shared in His Word in Isaiah chapter 5. First, God's parable about His work is clear. When Isaiah stood and spoke this, I'm guessing, ladies and gentlemen, this is probably in one of the harvest feasts that took place in the seventh month. Now, on the first day of the seventh month, there was one harvest feast. It was a one-day feast required for them to be wherever the tabernacle or later the temple was, which in this case is Jerusalem. On the 10th day of the seventh month was the Day of Atonement, which was hardly a feast. It was a day of solemn introspection. And on the 15th day was the Feast of Tabernacles, which was the celebration of the harvest that they had received during that time. So I believe that Isaiah is there where there are tens of thousands of people gathered for their festival, probably the Feast of Tabernacles. And he stands before them and he says, I want to sing you a song. Well, the Jewish people loved to have songs, and songs were a great part of everything they did. And they would walk the streets of Jerusalem singing songs, Jim, just as you read scripture this morning from Psalm 96. So he says, I'm going to sing you a song. And the song is this parable about God's work. The song is that God gave a vineyard that was carefully planted. What a beautiful picture he has for us. You see, the husbandman placed the vineyard in the best location, verse 1 tells us, on a very fruitful hill. That's important because you see, where you plant your garden is very, very important. You folks that still do gardening, you know exactly what I'm speaking about. You want it to get the best sun. In Israel, if you could get on a fertile hill, up on a hillside like that, and on the top of the hill, you would have sun hit that thing all day long. And for the grape crop especially, that was a very important thing to happen. The husbandman gave it his very best labor. And the husbandman used the most luscious vines he could possibly find in that particular day. So he had a good location, he had good hard work, hard labor, and he had the most luscious vines that you could use. The words that describe the kind of vine, the kind of grapes that he would have planted in that day are words of grapes that produce the most juice, that are the most fruitful on the vine itself, and they are the juiciest grapes that you could ever find. Well, the vineyard was carefully planted, but the vineyard was constantly protected. He put a tower in the midst of it. That tower is placed there in the midst of the vineyard for a specific purpose. The tower was a place of protection. It was a place of personal protection. God is saying to Israel, I've given you my personal protection. I've watched over you with everything I have. It also indicated personal presence and property rights. God was with Israel. God was with Judah. You remember in chapter 7 when we read that just a few weeks ago, he prophesied that a child would be born and they'd call his name Emmanuel, God with us. And it was a reminder to Israel, to Judah, God is with us. His personal presence is there. His property rights are there as well. And I don't want you to miss this because God, because he's always there with them, he has his personal seal on the nation of Judah. Church, God has placed upon every one of us his personal seal. Do you realize that? The book of Ephesians teaches you, as well as in Corinthians, 2 Corinthians, that you have been sealed by the Holy Spirit of God. God went to everyone who has repented and believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. Everyone who by an act of their own faith turned away from their sin and turned to the Lord Jesus Christ. And God has placed his seal on each and every one of us. He placed his seal on the nation of Israel. Don't miss that, folks. Very important. Well, it was a vineyard with soil that was correctly prepared. The Bible says that he went out and he removed the rocks and the stones. He fertilized, would have fertilized the soil. And he was so convinced that this was going to be a good crop that he even placed a wine press there. He was ready for his good crop to happen, to come forth at harvest time. But it was a vineyard with corrupt produce. Look down there in verse 2 at the bottom, the end of verse 2. He expected it to bring forth good grapes, but it brought forth wild grapes. Wild grapes in the Hebrew is a word that means stinkberry. Now, I don't know what a stinkberry is. It's a berry that stinks, somebody said. Did you say that, Sean? I'm guessing you're probably right. But I've never smelled a stinkberry. I've never been close to a stinkberry. But this is what I understand about stinkberries. It's not even fit for hogs or dogs. It's not good for anything whatsoever. That's what it was. It's not sour grapes, folks. It's a totally worthless, useless things. A produce that can only be remedied by removing the vine in the first place. This is what's important. He said, Judah, Jerusalem, I'm speaking about you. And this is what's going to happen to you because you are a vineyard. You are a vine with corrupt produce. And this is what's going to happen in your life. God's parable is a hard parable. That song would have started out so beautifully for all of those present. And when they heard what happened, they would have gasped and they would have said, why on earth would a place that's planted like this turn out this way? And then he turns and he points his finger, just like Nathan pointed his finger at David when David committed adultery with Bathsheba, and he looked at him and says, you're the man. And God looked at Israel and God looked at Judah and he said, I'm talking about you. I'm speaking about you. And so because of this, we have the second section of this message, which is God's proclamation of woes, and it amplifies what God is saying in verse 7. And let me just begin by reading verse 7, because he says, the vineyard of the Lord of hosts is the house of Israel. The men of Judah are his pleasant plant. He looked for justice, but behold, oppression. He looked for righteousness, but behold, a cry for help. And then he begins to amplify that in these proclamations that he makes. Verse 8, woe to those who join house to house. They add field to field till there is no place where they may dwell alone in the midst of the land. Ladies and gentlemen, the first problem that had begun to take place in the nation of Israel was a passion for prosperity. There was a great passion for prosperity. The nation was gripped by greed. I need to explain something to you that I came across in my Bible readings yesterday in the book of Leviticus. The Lord told them, you are not to sell your personal property. If you own property, you pass that property down from generation to generation. If there comes a time you must sell that property, then you will sell it to an individual. But when you are able to buy that back, you are permitted to go and buy that piece of property back from whomever you have sold it. And this is not what was happening in the nation. They were finding folks who were in a tight spot, in a bind, and they were going up to them saying, I can help you out. I know you need $1,000, and I just, you know, that little half acre you've got over there, I'll give you $1,000 for it. And they say, all right, and they would buy it. And then immediately they would construct on that piece of property, and they were just expanding, expanding, expanding. When the person came for right of redemption, they were saying, no way, I'm not giving this back to you. I'm using this piece of property. I have no way to give you this piece of property. That is not going to happen to you. It was a passion for prosperity, a nation that was gripped by greed. But God says, you're about to be a nation perplexed by poverty. You see, he tells them, in my hearing, the Lord of hosts said, verse 9, truly many houses shall be desolate, great and beautiful ones without inhabitant. Think of Detroit, Michigan, ladies and gentlemen. Think of Detroit, Michigan. Think of some of our large cities. When's the last time you took a drive down to New Orleans and you drive down there and there are entire neighborhoods you can drive through that are just empty? You know what I'm saying? Think of that for just a moment. The houses will be desolate, great and beautiful ones. Verse 10, 10 acres of a vineyard shall yield one bath. A homer of seed shall yield one ephah. Folks, he's talking about they got this big 10-acre farm, and all they're going to get from it is a gallon of juice from a 10-acre farm. And all they're going to get is a double handful of grain from the seeds that they planted. They're not going to have anything. They are going to be a nation in poverty. I'm telling you, and you listen to me very carefully, we're not far in the United States from reaching that very same place. Not that we are God's chosen people. Not that this nation is that kind of thing. But we are there. I still believe God blessed this nation in his foundation, and I believe God blessed this nation in many different ways. I believe that we were created to be a sending agency to the world, but to the degree we turn inward and quit looking outward at the world to send folks with the gospel message, to that degree the hand of God is coming off of us. At least you missionaries could say amen to that. It was a sad, sad sight. But there was not just a passion for prosperity, there was a passion for partying. Verse 11, woe to those who rise early in the morning that they may follow intoxicating drink, who continue until night, till wine inflames them. By the way, the word for intoxicating drink there is barley beer. Oh, yes, sir. They considered beer strong drink. We, ladies and gentlemen, have become a nation that loves to get buzzed. We have our love affair with Budweiser and what are some of the brands? Oh me. It's no longer alcohol though. Do you know, I read a story yesterday. Did y'all see that in the paper about the 2-year-old child in Colorado, in the great state of Colorado? You know, they just passed a pot law there. It's legal to buy pot, and you can grow pot, and you can sell pot. You can have a pot store. They probably have potty mouths, too, you know. But, you know, that 2-year-old girl, 2 years old! Reached down on the ground because she saw a cookie on the ground. And 2-year-old children don't discern that things can be clean or dirty if they're laying on the ground. And she picked that thing up and ate it, and she became violently ill. So when they tested her, and they tested her bloodstream and did all the blood tests, they discovered that she had ingested marijuana from that cookie. So we're a nation, man, we really got it together, don't we, guys? Pardon my grammar there. We really do. Galatians 5 teaches us that this passion for partying is a work of the flesh. The word that they use in Galatians 5 is revelries. Revelries. And we are living the consequences of that, which is found in verse 12. In verse 12, they do not regard the work of the Lord nor the operation of his hands. Therefore, my people have gone into captivity. The root of the problem is America no longer considers God. America no longer looks at God. To my Canadian friends, Canada no longer looks at God. We have begun to look elsewhere. We have a passion for partying. You can go every year and you can find the top 10 partying schools, colleges, universities in the United States of America. So far, we've not made it there. But at least one of them on the top 10 is playing for the championship game tomorrow night of the NCAA, and I hope they get whipped really good. Never thought I'd cheer for Auburn. They have a penchant for sin as well. The next woe that's listed in this passage of scriptures in verse 18, woe to those who draw iniquity with cords of vanity and sin as if with a cart rope, that say, let him make speed and hasten his work that we may see it, and let the counsel of the Holy One of Israel draw near and come home that we may know it. Isaiah describes this penchant for sin as someone who's got a hold of it, he's wrangled it, and now he's pulling it toward himself with a rope. And that's exactly the picture. Think of the cowboy when he ropes a steer and he begins to pull that steer towards him. And this is what's happening. They're dragging sin towards themselves, and to paraphrase what they're saying in this passage of scripture, they're saying, let's see God do something about it. They have no concern for any of the consequences that can take place. The fourth woe that he proclaims in this passage is in verse 20. Woe to those who call evil good and good evil, who put darkness for light and light for darkness, who put bitter for sweet and sweet for bitter. We are living in a time of perversion of truth, ladies and gentlemen. Listen to me. When you can kill almost 4,000 babies a day and be paid to do it, but kill one eagle and you go to jail for that, that's a perversion of truth, ladies and gentlemen. When a young teen can go to school nurse in most states and get birth control without their parents knowing about it in the name of personal privacy, that's a perversion of truth. When two men or two women can stand on the steps of the Supreme Court or on a float in the Rose Bowl parade like they did this year and marry one another, that is a perversion of truth. The fifth woe is the woe of pride. Verse 21. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes and prudent in their own sight. Dr. James Leo Green described these people as self-conceited and self-sufficient. It's the attitude of not needing God. The entire concept of religion, of evolution, points to that, by the way. Yes, I called it the religion of evolution. And the evolutionary gurus claim that we are evolving and becoming wiser and more skillful in every way. But Romans chapter 1, verse 22 says, professing themselves to be wise, they became fools. The sixth woe, some people say there are seven. That's all right. Most scholars take verse 21 and 22 and they combine them into one woe. Woe to those of perversion of power and justice. Woe to those who are wise in their own eyes. Woe to men mighty at drinking wine. Woe to men valiant for mixing intoxicating drink, who justify the wicked for a bribe and take away justice from the righteous man. Perversion of power and justice. These were men who were refined in the ways of the world, but these are men who are reprobate in the ways of righteousness, and you could bribe them. Folks, we've seen it. We lived it in South America. It was all around us. There were so many countries that you would go through in South America where you'd come to an intersection, they'd stop you. We got stopped. It used to be we'd ride down the roads when Pam and I'd be together when we first got to Peru. You couldn't make it through a day without being stopped by someone. And he'd say, you know, we're out of gasoline. Is that why you're walking? You're out of gasoline. Yes, sir. You know, we don't have any paper in our offices. And they're always looking for a bribe, these folks. It was a very frustrating thing. Don't think bribes don't happen here. There's a man named Dickie Scruggs that's in trouble right now for that very reason, is there not? Folks, don't think bribes don't happen here. They do happen here. They've just found more sophisticated ways of taking care of those bribes, except it seems to me like the current administration in power right now in the United States of America has been rather bold-faced with his bribes. He just awards people that have helped him get elected. He openly awards them and destroys the nation systematically with some of the ludicrous laws that he makes. But I'm not here to give a political speech. I'm here to tell you that's a perversion of power and justice. And God Almighty sees it. He takes notice of it. So what happens with that when God shows that particular thing? He gives us, ladies and gentlemen, a prophetic warning. And the rest of the chapter is dealing with his prophetic warning. And we will not deal with all of it, but let me show you some of the verses. In verse 24, he says, you will be devoured. Therefore, as the fire devours the stubble, as the flame consumes the chaff, so their root will be as rottenness, and their blossom will ascend like dust, because they have rejected the law of the Lord of hosts and despised the word of the Holy One of Israel. You will be devoured. Verse 25, you will face destruction. Therefore, the anger of the Lord is aroused against his people. He has stretched out his hand against them and stricken them, and the hills trembled, and their carcasses were as refuse in the midst of their streets. And you will experience defeat. Verse 26, he will lift up a banner to the nations from afar. He will whistle to them from the ends of the earth. Surely they will come with speed, swiftly. Ladies and gentlemen, this is what Israel, what Judah was facing in that moment. They were going to be devoured. They were going to be destroyed. Their armies were going to be defeated. Now, fast forward several hundred years, Jesus is standing with the disciples. He's walking at this point, and he's coming through, going to the Mount of Olives, to Gethsemane, where he's going to pray. Sometimes I wonder if that's exactly where Jesus is going to step when he comes back, because he says he will step on the Mount of Olives. I wonder if it's going to be in the Garden of Gethsemane. Y'all need to send me over there so I can go study that. And he looked at one of the vines and he said, "My, I am the vine and you are the branches. And my Father is the husbandman." And he looks at us and he says, the first vine didn't produce. God's planted a new vine. I'm the vine. Isn't it wonderful? He's grafted us in. Has he grafted you in? I don't know if he's grafted you in or not. How will you know if he's grafted you in? Have you, by an act of your own will, turned from sin and turned to the Lord Jesus Christ? Have you trusted the Lord? Have you placed your faith in Jesus? Is Jesus your Lord? If you died and you stood before God right now and God said, "Why should I let you into heaven?" would you be able to say, "Jesus is my Lord. He's Lord"? Can I tell you something? The Holy Spirit is inspecting us right now. Every one of us. He's inspecting us. He's looking at our leaves. He's looking at the branches. He's looking at the fruit. He's inspecting. It's His job to do it. It's not my job to do it. It's His job to do it. I'm the messenger. And it's His job to do it. Now, we live in a society with a passion for prosperity and a passion for a party life and a penchant for sin and a perversion of truth and pride and a perversion of power and justice. Even though we are supposed to be salt and light that impacts the world, I'm afraid too much the world impacts us with its stink berries. Church, this means that some of us needs to repent today. This means that all of us need to pray today for revival. This means we need to have compassion and show forgiveness to those who may have fallen in those devilish traps that I mentioned in this message today. We need to show that Christ fully forgives. And when a person repents and believes on the Lord, can I tell you something? The past is the past. My God says, "I won't remember your sins anymore." Why? Because a person who trusts the Lord is a new creation. Old things have passed away. A song. A cry by the Holy Spirit to our hearts. This is a day, a new year, a new opportunity, a new time for 38th Avenue to say, by the grace of God, I'm going to walk in victory and for His glory.